Bum, bum. So, let's talk about Should Have Been Me. This is the one from Laurel Hell. To get straight into it, I remember I think this is the first song where you gave me like songwriting criticism, which I hate. And then you were like, this verse melody is too busy. And I clutched my pearls first. But then I was like, you know what? You're right. And I took it back to my room and was like, let me rework this. The rest of Laurel Hell, too. At first, I wanted a lot of songs to be a lot more disco. But then it just wasn't working. Mm-hmm. And then so we took it up a decade.
Yeah, and it's also, I mean, maybe worth mentioning that a lot of this album was made during lockdowns.
Yes, we were in lockdown, and I was like, I cannot handle sad music production. Like, I am going crazy, and mm-hmm. I need something that I can overtly dance to, that is overtly just like more upbeat than what I usually do, because I can't write my usual sad songs and also put like melancholy accompaniment to it, because then it would just be too much. Like, it's just, mm-hmm. I just needed something lighter for the pandemic. Who did the drums for this again?
So Elizabeth Chan played drums on this.
That's right. But you were able to, because you were in the control room and she was in the live room.
A fun fact about this is that this is a first take.
Really?
Yeah.
I wasn't there for her, for like any of the takes, obviously, because we were social distancing. So yeah. I just put my trust in you and was like, you would just deal with it. Yeah.
And Elizabeth came in. She had already done drums on a few songs for us. Mm-hmm. And this was like a later addition mm-hmm. to the album. And then she came in and just did such a great first take. It was perfect.
One and done.
And then, Evan did his bass parts at home. And he is another one who, his first pass was had a lot going on.
Well, because he's so good at bass. I think that's the thing with like jazz players or people who are really proficient in their instrument. They eventually get bored of just the standard.
Yeah.
And he had a lot of notes in there.
And I had to be like, maybe do a little bit less. Mm-hmm. And then he'd come back and I'd be like, okay, maybe do a little less than that.
Until Evan. But it was because he's so good.
He's so good. He's too good for us, really.
Yeah.
And I did some guitars. I would say the rhythm section, one record I really love is Phil Collins' recording of You Can't Hurry Love. Obviously the song has the same kind of groove, and then I kind of tried to copy the guitars as well a bit.
Yeah, because Phil Collins in that track does a perfect blend of Motown updated for the 80s.
Yeah.
I like that. In the beginning, it wasn't an instrument. It was me saying, do-a-do-up, 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 to make it really Motown-y, but it just didn't sound right or something.
Yeah, and then these... Yeah, there's definitely some kind of Tears for Fears.
And then Marie does the dum-dum-dum-dum-dum.
Yeah, synthesizer stuff.
At first I thought this was harpsichord.
Thank you. But that's, the string breaks are very ABBA, aren't they?
What makes it feel very ABBA also is the modulation.
Yeah.
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 But yeah, but cause also, yeah. What's that ABBA song that's... Yeah. Oh, and then... I haven't given you what you need. You wanted me, but couldn't. That's really embarrassing. So you went into it's your so weird to just... all the way. To this day, it's still really weird to just hear my naked voice. If you bring a sad song in a sad tone, people just usually don't want to hear it. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you hide a sad feeling or like a negative feeling in a really upbeat song, then people, you get to trick people into listening, and then by the time they realize it's a sad song, you've got them.
If that part wasn't there. The same kind of, it would just be boring.
The imagery I was thinking of in terms of the lyrics for the second verse. Who's the beast in the maze?
The minotaur?
Yeah, I was thinking of like a minotaur in a maze. For this part, I was thinking of like the way I would often go somewhere else in my mind, and I would just like, I'd be doing dishes. And then suddenly I would like look up and realize 20 minutes have passed because I've just gone somewhere else in my mind for, so I was just thinking about that. How like I could be anywhere and then like some invisible hand can just like pick me out of where I am and put me in a mental maze, and then I'm just trapped in that maze for however long until I can get myself out of it, and then I can go back to doing the dishes. Yeah. How did we end this one?
It just ends like so many.
Oh, yeah. Da-da-da-da.